Hello everyone, today we'll discuss about key hierarchy, confidentiality and integrity. So in wireless LAN there are two types of keys. One is pairwise key. Pairwise key is to protect the communication between access point and single station. So whereas group key, it is used to protect the broadcast or multicast frames between access point and multiple workstation. Next we'll see key hierarchy. In the key hierarchy there are several keys are there. These keys are used to protect or to provide the security. First one is master session key. Master session key, it is used between authentication server and station during authentication procedure. So to authenticate the station, it uses the master session key and it authenticates itself to the authentication server. After that, these two are agreed to use this master session key for further communication. Next, later, authentication server will communicate with the access point and informs that we are agreed to use this master session key to communicate with the station. Later, this access point communicate with the station with the help of this master session key, and access point and station will derive the new key, that is the PMK, that is pairwise master key. In this way, we will get the 256-bit master key. Pairwise master key here. Also we can get this PMK with the help of the PSK. PSK means pre-shared key. So pre-shared key means, so on every session we'll get the fresh PMK, whereas using MSK, if you get the PMK, it is fixed for all the session. If you use the PSK, so for every sessions we'll get the new or fresh PMK. With the help of this PMK, next we can get the PTK. PTK means pairwise transient key. It is of 38-bit long. So now how we'll get this PTK with the help of PMK? Let's see. So for this PTK, you are using the PRF. PRF means what? Pseudo random function. And you are applying this pseudo random function for the message. That message contains what? Nouns of access point, nouns of station, MAC address of access point and MAC address of station, and this PMK. So now for this message you will apply the pseudo random function, and what are the output you will get? No, that one you will take as a PTK, pairwise transient key. And this pairwise transient key, once again it further derives or get the with the help of this PTK, we can get the three different keys. Those are TK. TK is temporal key, and next one is the KCK, key confirmation key, and key encryption key. These are the three keys of length 128-bit, and these keys are derived from PTK. And here this temporal key you are used for encryption purpose and also for provide the integrity. And KCK, this is the important key, that is key confirmation key. Usually this is the key used to get the message integrity check. Okay, MAC, that is the one of the procedure you are using or your function you are using for every message to get the MIC, that is the MIC, we are using this KCK, and this is for the integrity protection purpose. For check the integrity protection, KCK is used. Next, last one is the key encryption key, and this key encryption key is used to encrypt the message which contain group of keys. So multiple keys if you are having along with the message, for encrypting such type of the keys you are using key key, and for integrity protections you are using KCK, and temporal key for both for encryption and for the integrity purpose here. Next one is four-way handshake. The main goal of four-way handshake is to derive the PTK from PMK. So now you already know that how we'll get the PMK, PTK. So with the help of the PMK, you are performing this, okay, pseudo random function on this message, you will get the PTK. To perform or to derive this PTK, you are using the four-way handshake. The first gain of the goal of the four-way handshake is to derive the PTK. And next one is the verify the cipher suits communicated in the beacon and associate request frame. These are the two frames we'll get from whom? So these are the two frames we'll actually receive from access point, and to verify that is also one of the goal of the four-way handshake. Next is communicating the group keys from the AP to the station. So multiple keys if you want to communicate, that is also one of the goal of the four-way handshake. These are the three goals of the four-way handshake. First one is to derive the PTK, and next one is to verification of the beacon and associate request frames, and last one is the communication of the group keys to from AP to workstation here. Let's see how actually four-way handshake works. Now station and access point. First access point will tell that I am here. Okay, in this range what are the stations will come? Yes, you can communicate. So communicate with the help of me, access point. So for that, first it sends the message to inform that I am coming in your range to the stations. It generates a request frame. That frame only what you call BCOM. So in that BCOM, what is the message it contains? That message is the nouns. Okay, NA nouns here. This is the nouns is means what it is? Random number. It is generated by the access point and it sends that to as a station here. And this is the first request message you are getting from access point. That's why this message what you call this frame or actually call as a beacon. And after on receiving the station, so station will generate a second message. That message contains what? Nouns of the station and cipher suit and mic. So mic, MIC is a message integrity check. As I told earlier, you will generate a message integrity check with the help of which key? That is the KC key. So this KC key will get from which key? That is the PTK. PTK you will get from this pseudo random function. Okay, after applying for this message you will get PTK, and from the PTK we'll get the KCK, and with the help of this key we'll generate a message integrity check. Okay, and that is the function you are using to check the integrity, and you are forwarding that message to access point. Whenever this access point will receive that message, it perform the same function with the help of KCK. Okay, KCK key, it perform message integrity check. So now what are the message integrity check, what are the value you will get? No, that value if it is matches with the this MIC, then it is the meaning of this one is what? Access point will ensure that yes, it is the integrity protected. So now with the help of this one, if I communicate with the any station, that message is protected, it is integrity protected, no one is allowed to modify that particular message. It confirms, and after confirmation it sends that confirmation to the all the stations here. So for sending that, it is generates a third message. That message contains what? Group transient key. Group transient key means what it is? Now this AP want to send the integrity protection related information to all the workstations here. So to inform to all other workstation, it contains the multiple keys, and that multiple keys only you call as a group transient key and cipher suit and mic. That is the message integrity check. And this old message is encrypted using which key? That is the KE key. Okay, key encryption key. As told earlier, if you want to encrypt any message, that message if it contains message along with the message multiple keys, this is your multiple keys, then to encrypt that message usually use which key? That is the KE key. KE key for encrypting the multiple keys, and KC key for integrity protection purpose, and TK is for individual. Okay, individual message encryption for particular station if you want to encrypt that message encryption, and for particular station integrity verification if required, then you go for this temporal key here. Okay, in this way this third message will be sent to the station. On receiving, station will acknowledge with the okay message. This is how four-way handshake will perform to check the integrity here. Same thing is explained here, you read it. Next one is the security protocols in Wi-Fi. You already know that there are three protocols are available, but in these three protocols also are hanged some of the loopholes. And to overcome those loopholes in the web, that is the wired equivalent protocol, you are used Wi-Fi protected access protocol. And to overcome the loop of this one, you are using WPA version 2 protocol. So let's see how, what are the problems arise with this security protocols one by one. As we already know that there is the loopholes in the WEP, that is the web. So confidentiality and integrity. Now we'll see the confidentiality and integrity in WEP. You already know that it is failed. How it is failed and what is the procedure it is followed, that one let's see. First we'll see what is confidentiality. Confidentiality means what? It's kept the information private and secure. Okay, what are the information you want to transfer between the stations to access point and between access point to server, that one must be you want to private and secure. That is what you call as a confidentiality. Next is the integrity. What are the data you communicate? No, that data not modified or deleted or added. Okay, the data you want to transfer as it is. If it is received as it is, then you call that one as a integrity here. Okay, so now in the web, encryption and integrity checking, how it takes place, let's see. Usually for the encryption, it uses the RC4 encryption algorithm, and RC4 encryption algorithm is a stream cipher. Stream cipher means what? In sequence, it encrypts the message here. So for encrypting the message here, this is the equation you are using. What? C means what? Ciphertext equal to. If you want to get the ciphertext, first you have to encrypt the message. P means plain text, and the symbol indicates XORed with the key stream. So this is the key stream. This key stream contains what? S and the initialization vector. S is the shared key. So that key is used for encryption, okay, encryption and for the decryption. And initialization vector is what? Some random number, and that random number you are, and the shared key you are using as a key stream here. Okay, so now this key stream is XORed with the plain text, then you will get the ciphertext here. So this is the one example of the frame here. MAC address, that is the MAC header is what? Address of the MAC. Okay, so it may be the source MAC address and destination MAC address. To whom you want to send, that MAC address is comes under in this MAC header. Initialization vector, this is the random number, okay, as a nouns. It is of 24 bits and encrypted plain text. What are the plain text you are having? No, that one is encrypted, and along with that you are having one more thing, that is cyclic redundancy check. This is the checksum. This checksum is used to check for the integrity, and you will calculate the checksum. And what are the checksum will get? No, that checksum you are encrypted here. Checksum is of 32 bits here. Then we'll get there's a ciphertext, and that ciphertext will send to the receiver. On receiving, that receiver will decrypt. For decrypting, this is the procedure. If you want to get your plain text back, that is what you call as a decryption. So encryption to get the ciphertext and decryption to get the plain text. So now that receiver have the ciphertext and XORed with the key stream, and that key stream is having the shared key. That shared key is already known by the receiver also, and initialization vector. So now after that we'll get the plain text. This is how encryption and integrity checking is takes place in this WEP. Now it is procedure is over. Now we have to check how much it is secured here, but it is not resist against the known plain text attack here. Known plain text attack. See here you are using the key stream that is of 24 bits random number. This is the initialization vector. This is the only one thing you are using as a security here. And shared key, it is already shared one. What is the length of this one is 24 bit here. Okay. So now initialization vector is the 24 bit length means what? So now for the messages, if you want to encrypt with the initialization vector, then how many initialization vector will get for your all possible messages? That is 2 to the power of 24 here. So then meaning of that, if it exceeds that limit, next message will repeat the same initialization vector. So assume that P and P dash, these are the two plain text, and these two plain text is encrypted using the same initialization vector. So now if it is the case, usually attackers always continuously they will monitor the what are the communication will takes place. So then if they get to know that this P and P dash are two plain text are encrypted using the same ciphertext, then actually this one P XOR with the P dash I is equal to C XOR with the C dash. This is the ciphertext is obtained for the this P dash plain, and this is the ciphertext obtained for this plain text. So this one if you are XOR, then you will get the ciphertext result, both are same here. This is known by the attacker. So then with the help of this equation they will calculate. So now usually P dash is equal to what now? P XOR with the ciphertext and XOR with the C ciphertext dash here. So with the help of this, if I know the what is the plain text and what is the ciphertext for that plain text and what is the ciphertext for the P dash, I don't know what is P dash, but with the help of these three I can get the P dash here. So this is what you call as a known plain text attack here. Due to the limitation of the bit key length, you can easily retrieve what is your plain text with the help of known plain text attack here. So it does not resist against this text attack here. And one more V is there. So that is for the getting the key length. Even you can also modify the messages. Integrity check also it varies. This is the verification for the encryption. Okay. Encryption key you are using, but with the help of this known plain text, you can get the what is the plain text. Even your text is encrypted. You have the ciphertext here. With the help of the ciphertext, I can get the plain text here. This is about the loopholes of the encryption. Next is the one more loophole is integrity check. So for example, this is the M1, M2 and sum function. This is the sum message. Okay, this message is concatenated with the CRC. CRC is what? Checksum. That is the checksum you have calculated for this old message and XORed with the key stream here. And this one you have forwarded as a secured purpose here. Let's see how this message is modified by the attacker here. So M1, M2 and F here. So now for example, attacker will intercept this ciphertext by performing the following operation. What that attacker will do, they will perform this operation. What is this operation? O of MN. MN is what? It is add MI. This attacker don't know what is M1. Even attackers don't know what is the message M2. So, but with the help of the F message, that is the one of the function. So, now it can generate its own function as F dash and it can get the that modify the that particular message. How? Let's see here. So that's why here it add the M1 as a zeros as a length. It know based on the length it adds that much of zeros for the M1 and zeros for the M2, and it know F and it generates the F dash here, and it perform the XOR with the F and F dash here. After performing that, even it don't know that what is the checksum they used, because for integrity purpose they use the CRC as a method, and it also calculates the same CRC for its message, because it don't know what is M1, even it don't know what is M2 in the original message, but each attacker is able to get this F here. With the help of this F, it modify that as a F dash here. For performing that, this is the operation you did, it will perform, and afterwards whenever you XOR with this message operation, okay, whatever you are obtained, and that message if you are XOR with the original ciphertext, no, then you will get the message like this: CRC M1 XOR with the M2. This CRC is the linear function here. It is linear function. Then I can separate like this: CRC M1 XOR CRC M2. Actually, this is your ciphertext and this is the your checksum here. So here your checksum is what? M1, F and M2. So if I perform the XOR here, okay, like this, I can separate the M1 CRC and M2 CRC, and in the place of CRC of F, now what is the CRC will add now? F dash here. Okay, so now in the place of F, now I am adding what? F dash, and even I also calculate this F dash is the message created by whom? It is created by the attacker. Actual virtual machine message is F. That message is modified as a F dash, and for that F dash you are already calculated as a CRC. So now like that, it in the place of F, it adds F dash, and in the place of CRC of F dash, it adds the F. Okay, in the place of the F CRC, it adds the CRC of the F dash here. Checksum if you calculate, no. So when the receiver receive, if they calculate, so now after calculation, now receiver will calculate the CRC for M1 and CRC for M2 and CRC for F dash only. If same CRC value if a receiver will get, then what receiver will think that? Yes, this is the original message and integrity is protected. Is it protected here? See, that message is modified. Along with the message, CRC value is also modified. And this thing is hidden by sender and the receiver. Whenever the receiver will receive, they will calculate the CRC for F dash only. So same CRC they will get for the F dash. So in this way, even integrity is also not protected in the WAP here. This is the problem in the first one. That's why that is WAP security protocol is failed here. So now to overcome from those problems, you are having the one more version of the security protocol, that is the WAP. So in the WAP, it is actually technical name for this protocol. What is this protocol? Temporal Key Integrity Protocol. For this protocol, you are technically given a name as a WAP. And here in this also, you are having the sum of the drawbacks. To overcome from those drawbacks, you are using the higher version of that one. That is the WPA2 here. And technical name for this, okay, it is actually technical name for the counter mode with CBC MAC protocol. Let's see how these two provide the security and that confidentiality and integrity for the your messages. First one is the TKIP. So this is the encryption key. Here it uses of the length 128 bits, and it uses two-phase key mixing procedure here. Instead of using one phase, it is performing the multiple phase encryption, and afterwards it forwards. In this way, it provides the security from the known plaintext attack. And even size of this key is what? 128 bits. Whereas in the earlier you are using the 24 bit key, that's why that is the problem here. It is very long, so that's why it is resist against the known plaintext attack also. And here for the encryption, you are using the RC4 encryption algorithm. How it works, let's see. This is your temporal key, and this temporal key of size 128 bit, and sender MAC address is of size 48 bit, and sequence counter. This is the frame sequence counter, and for first MSB of the, that is the four most significant bytes of the sequence counter is extracted, that is of 32 bits, and these things are input for the phase one here. This PRF means what it is? Pseudo random function. And for this pseudo random functions, inputs are these 128 bit TP and 48 bit MAC address sender, and 32 bit is the first four MSB of the frame sequence counter. And after performing pseudo random function, we get the output. That output is of 80 bits. Once again, for this second phase 2, you are taking the two inputs. One input is of this one, 80 bits, and two LS bytes of a frame sequence counter. Earlier, you have taken the 4 MSB, and now you are taking the 2 LSB here, okay, of size 16 bits here. And these two are the inputs for the second pseudo random function here. And after that, you will get a 104 bits, and that one and frame sequence counter of 24 bits you will take as a RC4 for frame key. Here you'll get the frame key. This frame key is generated in this way here. And here you are using the 64 bit as a MIC. MIC means what it is? Message integrity check here. So in this way you are generating the key. This is the RC4. This is the key you are using for encrypting the messages here. So next, along with that, you are adding the integrity protection. That integrity protection is offline 64 bit here. And you are sending the things here. These are the two things. This is RC4 for encryption and MIC for the integrity purpose you are using in this TKIP. But here also you are adding the one drawback. So how you calculate this MIC? MIC is a message integrity check. For that you are performing some function. That function is limited to use only the logical shift operator. This is the C here. Only you are using the shift register, okay, MSB bits and LSB bits, and you are performing the shift operation to get the MIC. It is good than the CRC. If you are compare with the earlier version, you are using the checksum. That is, if you are compare with that one, this function is good because here you are using the logical shift function to check the integrity. It is good than CRC, but it is not enough to provide the integrity here because only limited here. So if attacker guess once, then easily they can modify you the they can perform the same shift operation for the integrity purpose. So to overcome from this drawback, you are using the another security protocol, that is the WPA2 version. This version, it overcome the all the drawbacks of the WEP and WAP, and that actual protocol name is CCMP, counter mode with CBC MAC protocol. It is a block cipher, and here for encryption you are using the AES encryption algorithm, and encryption key length is 128 bit key here. So now here you are using the block cipher. Block cipher means what? First you will divide the your message that into the number of packets. Okay, so P1, P2, P3, all these are the number of packets. Instead of finding earlier you are using the stream cipher, all message you are considering in sequence and you are encrypting. But here you are dividing the message as a packets, as a blocks, and each block you are encrypting separately here. And here for the MAC you are using this block, and for encryption you are using this part here. Let's see how it works. Initialization vector. Initialization vector, it includes 48 bit packet number. So, and this is once again the pseudo random number. And this pseudo random number is varying for all the messages. So that's why it is not repeated. Same initialization vector you are not using here. For every messages you are getting the different initialization vector and temporal key, and temporal key and initialization vector. So now with the help of this one, you will encrypt. After encryption, what are the ciphertext you will get? No, that one you will take as a input to the next level here. Here you are using AAD1 and AAD2. These are the two blocks. These are additional authentication data. These are the data you are using for authentication purpose. These are not the message. What actually authentication information contains? MAC address, sequence control, and frame type. Okay, which type of the frame it is, what are the sequence control, and MAC address what it is. These two are the that data, and this data is encrypted, and this data and initialization vector is encrypted. That one you are taking, okay, ciphertext of the initialization vector and AAD1 or an XOR. After XORing, what are the output you'll get? No, that one is encrypted using the temporal key. And there, where what are the output you'll get? No, that is your ciphertext. That one, once again, you'll take as a input to the next block. And here you are having the AAD2, that is also contain what? It is the authentication data and the ciphertext XOR. After that, what are the output you'll get? No, that one is encrypted using the temporal key here. And that ciphertext is you are taken as the input. That one is XORed with the P1. P1 is the packet 1, and XORed. After XORed, what are the output you'll get? No, that one is encrypted. This procedure is repeated until all the packets are completed. P1 to PN is the number of packets and each packets are numbered. Okay, so that's why on the receiver side also they will maintain the sequence of the packet numbers. Any packet if it is missing and same packet if it is replay, then it is easily identified. In this way even it prevents from the replay attack also. So now at the end what are the output you'll get? No, that one you are taking as a what? Message integrity check here. This is the message integrity procedure here. Next is you are using the encryption. Now you have to encrypt the message. This is to get the message integrity check value. Okay, this message integrity check you are getting. Now you have to want to encrypt the message. For encrypting the message you are using the count. Count is a function of the packet number. So as I told here, you are divided as the packets. Those packet number also are sending, that are maintaining in the count here. And A1 what it contains? Packet number. Okay, and this is the first packet and some random number. Even for encryption also you are using the some constant random number, and that random number is known by sender and the receiver. After adapting this two, you will encrypt. Okay, what are the encryption you will do for that one? For encryption you are using the temporal key and you will encrypt. Okay, after encryption you will get the A1. A1 contains what? Just packet number, and this is your first block. Okay, I indicates what? First block and some one constant number. You add up this thing and whatever the number you will get, no, that one is encrypted. And after encryption what are the ciphertext you will get? No, that is your A1, and that A1 and packet 1 are XOR, then you will get the ciphertext 1. Like this you will repeat for all the packets, all the ciphertext, because it is the block ciphers. In the block you will encrypt here. So at the end, in the last packet after completion, so now next packet is what it is? Last packet, and you concatenated with the message integrity check, and these two are XOR, then you will get the one extra ciphertext block, that is the C of N+1. C of N plus 1 you are using for integrity purpose here. In this way this method it works. Same thing it is explained here. On the receiver side same procedure it perform in the reverse order, and it verify the MAC verification. Same thing here. For this one also, first it receives, it extracts the C, okay, this CN package, last packet, and also MIC separate, and it perform the same procedure from the last in the reverse order, then you will get the initialization vector, and with the help of that you can calculate the integrity value, and with the help of that you can check whether it is the same or different. If it is different, then meaning of that one is what? Integrity is not protected. If it is same, yes, integrity is protected. Okay. So this is how actually you are protecting the data. That is, for data protection you are using the two terms, confidentiality. For the confidentiality, privately and securely you want to send, for that you are using the procedure of encryption. And for integrity you are using the different types of the integrity function. Okay, so in this way you will protect your data here using this three different types of the protocols. These are the security protocols used to provide the confidentiality and the integrity. Thank you.